Hey team, on today's episode of the podcast, we have Rich Dorment, Editor-in-Chief of Men's Health. We talk about the importance of being with change. Obviously, Rich, man, you're a relatable person, particularly when it comes to your readers. And we cook up a baller white bean harissa coconut curry, guys. Check this one out. Rich Dorment, Editor-in-Chief of Men's Health. Welcome to the podcast.
Dan, I'm thrilled to be here in your kitchen.
Thanks, man. I did ask, had you listened to any episodes? And naturally, you listen to Liz Plosser, fantastic woman, obviously Editor-in-Chief of Women's Health. It's cool to see that there is actually a really cool family at Hearst. And you guys obviously hang out, probably high five and do a workout together, no doubt.
Absolutely. I mean, we share a floor. So there's a lot of like intramural sort of competition and collaboration. But it's funny. I mean, men's health has been around for about 30 years. And I guess women's health has been around for almost 10.
Yeah, sure.
And so we share a lot of the same DNA and a lot of the same goals for our readers.
Is there like a, you know, like intercollegiate championships? Is there like inter-health competitions? Like who can do the most chin-ups?
You know what I was going to say? I bet women's health would like there to be because they would win. but no, we just a lot of, you know, high fives. But it's funny, once a month we do a sort of all staff outing where we go and we investigate and try out different sort of fitness things throughout the city. So like we've been, have you been to Burn?
Yeah, so we've of course, been, the boys at Burn.
Yeah, so that's like HIIT classes in like sub-zero temperatures, CBD yoga, special stretching classes, because if we're going to be writing about it and covering it for our audience, we should really experience it firsthand. And so that's something that we tend to do with our pals at Women's Health because it's fun for the entire staff, but it's also super important to keep on top of stuff.
100%. I'd love to see Rob and, oh, sorry, I'd love to see Rich and Liz compete on a hit and slide class at Burn. The boys there, I'm going to shout out to them, Jimmy and Johnny, they're epic. So like, I know when I'm there, it's like that. It's putting together that aerobics Oz style, but with a slide board. Yep. So I reckon there'd be some fantastic coordination challenges right there, my man.
She'll kick my butt.
Yeah,
as in all things in life, Liz would kick
my
butt.
Well, actually, I'm going to throw down a challenge for you today at one point. She nailed the one-handed egg crack, which no doubt you heard on the podcast. Uh-huh. So I have to put you up to the same challenge later on in the show. So before we get into that, though, let's talk a bit about Rich and obviously being the editor-in-chief of probably the biggest well-respected health magazine, in my opinion. That's a big deal. That's a huge deal. So how did Rich get to be that person who kind of points and shoots with an awesome collaborative team?
Right. First off, I don't think I got to be anybody. I'm still becoming that person. I think every single day we're sort of, you know, we're all sort of redefining our role. And learning every day. So I still see it very much as an ongoing process. I've been a journalist for about 18 years.
Yep.
My first real job was at a magazine called Esquire.
Yep.
It's a very old magazine for men. And my background is really what's called a generalist in journalism, which is that I can do a little bit of everything. So I can do lifestyle, I can do culture, I can do fashion, I can do politics. I can edit all these different types of stories, all filtering them through a common point of view and a common voice. I was there for about 10 years, where I learned a lot about how the lives of men are changing and how the perceptions and practices of manhood are changing, something we've seen a lot of over the last 10 or 15 years. After that, I went to a magazine called Wired, which is primarily about technology and the world of big tech. And that was really a sort of steep education in how the world is changing around us, how the way that technology and all these different platforms that are innovative and disruptive and maddening and revelatory are changing the way that we experience the world. So I was there for about 2 years. So when there was an opening at Men's Health and Hearst, the company that owns us, came looking for someone, I like to think that they saw in me somebody who understood what it meant to edit a magazine about change that was geared at men. And so that's primarily what Men's Health is all about, which is that not only are the lives of men changing, but what we think about when it comes to health and fitness and wellness is changing each and every day. So whether, I mean, I certainly didn't plan this and I couldn't have reverse engineered it if I tried, but I think all of my experience leading up to this has led me to be in a place, in a pretty good place for editing this brand right now.
Man, there's a few things you said that really defy who you are, I can tell as a person. Like first off, you talk about how you went from a men's magazine or more men's skewed to one that's, are you passionate about like technology? Are you at all? Because Wired is,
I'm passionate about change, as something that we all experience.
Sure.
Every single day. Some of us embrace it, some of us fear it.
Yeah.
Some of us absorb it, some of us repel it. It's happening whether we like it or not. And so at a place like Wired, where I primarily focused on long form features, which is to say really long stories, that were all about how all these characters and events transpired around change, that was really interesting to me. When it comes to like, you know, IPOs and things like that, that is where you sort of lose me.
Sure.
When it comes to things like big tech.
Yeah.
I'm really interested about the impact it has on everyday lives and how people like you and me are adjusting to it on a daily basis.
And what is, like, defy change? Because change can be so many different things, but what was it, like, what is it, on here I always try to get people to talk passionately about something, and naturally they do. And it sounds like change is so within your reach of just know, like what is known, right? So for you, what is change and how does it apply to men's health that got you that position?
Well, I think it can mean a couple of different things. One is obviously innovation in the world around you.
Sure.
You know, and that comes in the form of novelty, new things, right? What are we to make of these new things in our lives? And sometimes that's an object and something you can buy. Sometimes it's a perception or a practice. How do you make sense of that? And how, as a journalist, do I give my audience context to understand that, right? Because context is really important.
Super important.
Especially right now in the social media age, we tend to think that everything is happening for the first time. And of course, that's not true. A lot of these things have happened a lot of times in the past. And so what we have, you know, with my deep bench of experts, is to help us provide context for how all these new things are happening. Then there's just sort of personal circumstances. Can I curse on here?
Of course you can.
So like shit happens, right? Like that's change. And a lot of times that's outside of our control because obviously we're just one unit in a sort of interpersonal constellation. How do we adapt to those changes? And how do we sort of keep our feet on the ground when it's moving beneath us? Sometimes you make shit change, right? You make shit happen because you feel stuck, because you feel unfulfilled, because maybe you feel like you don't have a choice. Taking those proactive steps can be terrifying and confusing, but it can also be exhilarating. So that's something else that we try to equip our audience with, which is information and inspiration. The sort of log line, which is to say sort of the mantra of the magazine, is stronger, faster, better. And our goal with the brand is to give people the information, the inspiration, and the entertainment they need to become stronger, faster, better versions of themselves. That drive towards self-improvement often comes from inside. It comes from something that you feel like needs to happen. But sometimes it comes from external forces too.
Definitely. Like the most, like I guess the best beneficial form of motivation is intrinsic. Because mm-hmm. at the end of the day, if you tell yourself, I'm going to get up and go to the gym because I want to, it's more likely than someone saying you've got to go to the gym because someone else is telling you. But there are other influences from body image right through to what people are telling you about health and wellness, what you meant to do. So
right.
At the point of all that, you have the voice, so to speak, to help dictate and educate people on that, which is quite a responsibility as well.
It is. And I try not to use a word like dictate because
sure.
I think that feels a little bit more instructive
yep.
than I like. I like guiding.
Love
I
that.
Like inspiring. I like helping.
Yep.
Men's Health is primarily a service publication, which is to say we serve our audience. They tell us what they want, or we guess what they want, and we provide it to them.
So all these things you're talking about now with change, attitude, and perception, were these things that were instilled in you from a young age? Or did you kind of develop them in your journalism experiences yourself? Like, how did Rich really embody this mantra that you're talking about? Because obviously you've not just been the only editor-in-chief of Men's Health, you've taken on some phenomenal people in their past as well, and then you know you now have the ability to steer the ship to the way that you think is the, along with your team collectively, the best way to go. But how did you know, for you to instill this, what did you learn and what experience did you have?
I think the most important element of my childhood, sort of what led me here, was a sense of curiosity that I think I modeled after observing my dad. But I was always just a sort of sponge as far as what was happening in the world around me, whether that was politics or culture or what was sort of happening in a larger sort of social way. I've always, you know, the more what we call content, the more content the better. The more I could read, the more I could listen to. I sort of soaked it all up. And I think that, more than anything, prepared me for the career that I chose, because I think a journalist has to have a really sound basis of information upon which to sort of build the rest of their work. I mentioned this idea before of context. That's something that a journalist can do pretty much better than anybody, which is to provide context, both in historical sense, but also what's happening elsewhere in the culture to make this little thing make sense. So that's something I've always had, and I only sort of weaponized it, so to speak, when I went into journalism.
Unreal. And did you envision the one day you'd be an editor-in-chief of a magazine or of a digital platform? Or did you kind of start out doing your thing, go, oh, this journalism thing's pretty cool, I can you know, provide context?
Dan, it is terrible, but I always wanted to be an editor-in-chief.
That's awesome.
But
why is that terrible?
Because I think, it's not something I would ever recommend to anybody else, because I think it is, I like to think that there's a difference between being ambitious and being careerist. So careerist is when you are governed by things like titles and roles. That's all well and good, and if you get those things, that's great, but those can be taken away from you, and then you're left with just who you are. If you're ambitious, which is to say you're driven to improve yourself or to try to do great things, those are accomplishments that stay with you no matter what. Now, the good thing is if you're ambitious and you're good at it, you'll get all the other stuff. But if you're a careerist, you might fail upwards. You might end up with a fancy job title that you maybe don't deserve. People won't respect you. And they're like, well, what does he have to show for it? Nothing. So there's a difference between those two things. And I think, unfortunately for me, I felt early on in my career that, like, I really wanted to be an editor-in-chief because I thought that I had the values and the vision and the sort of direction to really drive a brand in the way that I wanted to. And I set myself up to be disappointed. It's a really high bar, particularly there those days where there aren't that many big magazine brands left. And I think had this not happened, had I not been in the right place at the right time with the right background and had this opportunity, it just would have been a bummer. So I'm sitting here from the other side and, like, knock wood, it's going okay so far. But I think by setting up that standard for myself, it was just almost like Charlie Brown with the football, right? Only this time I actually kicked it.
That's sick. Okay, so I love the way you kind of separated that. 100%. I feel there's people want the title, 100%, particularly in this city, New York. Like, people want the title and everything comes with the accolades. Then there's the people who want to do good. And the title, it means something as a result of being the figurehead behind a movement they're talking about. Mm-hmm. So for you, are you saying that initially it was the title you wanted, or mm-hmm. are you in the role and as a result then you want to do good, or did you grow throughout your time and then get the role as a result of being ambitious?
That's a really good question. There is a moment. And so I landed at Esquire when I was like 25 or 26, and it was my dream job.
Oh, that's awesome.
I loved the magazine. The editor who ran it was an icon. I wouldn't even say a mentor because I didn't know him at the time. But he was somebody I really looked up to, and I really admired his work. So to be able to work there at 25 was like kind of like, oh shit, what do I do now?
Sure.
So I was there for like 5 or 6 years, and I was doing really great work. But when you're really happy and comfortable in a job and you're really enjoying it and you're doing all these things, like, you're not going anywhere, right? And this whole sort of like impossible standard that I set up for myself, like, no one was just gonna give me that. So it was like, what do I do? And I think at a certain point when I was like 29 or 30, I kept having the same refrain come to my mind, which is the work has to be the reward. That I can't be doing this for money. I can't be doing this for status. I can't be doing this for a job title. I have to be doing this because the work is the reward. And that was a total paradigm shift as far as what motivated me and how I found value in my work. Because obviously anybody that goes into journalism thinking they're going to get rich is too stupid to be a good journalist. And, you know, given all the challenges, both in the broader industry, but also just the challenges you face getting to those top jobs, I mean, it's really hard to get there. So again, this idea that I'd set up for myself and that I would inevitably be disappointed, like that was a big downer for me when I sort of hit that 30 mark and I was like, what am I gonna do now? But when I changed my thinking around it, and again, it was something that came internally. It was not something like nobody sat me down. It was just something that where I just sort of shifted my thinking and that changed everything. And so for the next, you know, 6 to 8 years, most of that at Esquire, but some at Wired, I just threw myself into my work. The more ambitious, the more unexpected, the better for me. And that's, you know, there were a lot of times when I was up on the high rope or the tight wire without a net. There were a lot of times I could have failed spectacularly. I did a few times, but that's what really drove me, was just sort of really finding the enjoyment in the work.
That's awesome. That's so cool. Like, I just hearing that, there's so many people going to be listening going, oh, that's so much reassurance for me. You know, because there's people who are admittedly doing it for some reasons, and that's great for them. You know, whether it be a number in their bank account or, you know, to get the girl there, whatever it is. But then there's people who actually like go, I'm getting to this point where I really want to be doing good. Like, it's generally, this is a generalization, but I feel between that 27 to 35 mark, they're going, I've been working for X amount of years now, and it's really not as fulfilling. I may be onto a really good, like, you know, foundation, some security, but what am I actually leaving behind as a legacy? Or what am I doing for me that actually fulfills me outside of that number? Mm-hmm. Or that, you know, that figure? And then that is so awesome to hear, because that's when the people go, maybe I'm not actually where I want to be. And maybe it means I have to take the jump as opposed to wonder to think about what that is. Now, you didn't necessarily take a jump into a different industry. You just kind of changed your thinking. And when you say you started to use more ambition, what do you mean by that? What was your ambition? What was that internal clock that helped you actually activate and action the lead to where you are now?
I don't think it was a specific catalyst. I don't think there was like, I was holding back and now I'm just gonna do this. It was just really like throwing myself, and not like in a workaholic sense, but really just throwing myself and my full creative energies into work and almost having like a, like, why the fuck not attitude.
Yeah, cool.
Like, just give it a try. And again, I should note, like, there's nothing wrong with doing stuff for money. I just happened to enter a field where that was not really the point.
No, of course.
So if somebody's like a bond trader, or like working at like a PE fund or a hedge fund, and like they're just trying to add zeros to their bank account, like, God bless.
Yeah.
If that's what gives them satisfaction,
100%.
I am all for it, and I'm jealous, sort of. Like, I wish it were, I wish I could.
I wish
do
you
that.
Were motivated
yeah.
by that.
I was actually an econ major in college for 2 years okay. until I realized that I hated math and I was bad at it.
Okay.
So that, you know, if only, you know, sure. if only I were good at it and I enjoyed it, this would be a different conversation. So no, there was not a specific catalyst. It was just really throwing all my creative energies into it, creating opportunities for myself, making sure that the sense of entitlement wasn't there.
Like, yep.
You know, I'm somebody who's been given a lot, both just from the various privileges of growing up.
Given or earned? Like, there's a
given.
Given?
Like, straight up given.
Straight up.
And I'm talking about all the privileges that sort of, you know, white, male, cisgendered, all of that I grew up with, you know, in an upper middle class household. You know, I got to go to college, all those things. So that was all given to me.
Sure.
And I am hugely mindful of that. But also throughout my career, I've been given a lot of opportunities, and like, whether or not I earned them, like, you know, who's to say, but a lot of people have helped me up the ladder. So I really don't want to make it sound like I like made my own fortune or whatever, but there are times when I can look back and say, like, yes, I did that.
Yeah.
That would not have existed had I not stuck my neck out, came up with a stupid idea, came up with an idea that was impossible to execute, and yet here we are. So I think there's a little bit of both there.
100%. And when you talk about the way you just did, about knowing what you were given, it means that when you say you earned something, people can trust you. It's like...
I hope so.
No, I really believe that. Because if I say to someone like, you know, I was given all this, and it's like you are acknowledging how fortunate you were to get something as a result of, you know, what you were born into, mm-hmm. or, you know, what you're surrounded by. But then when you say, but on the other side, I absolutely earned this. Mm. I think I personally will stand as the people going, well, when he says that, if he's being, not vulnerable, but if he's being so open about what he was given, so when he says how open he is to being what he earned, mm-hmm. you 100% can be trusted.
Well, and that's what's interesting about this moment in time, and something that we probably wouldn't be talking about if this were like 5 years ago. I think a lot of us are much more aware of those conversations. We certainly have the vocabulary now where we didn't before.
Sure.
So that I think we can all just be much more honest about where we are in life and where we aren't, which is equally important. And that's part of the conversation that we're trying to have with our audience in Men's Health, which is, you know, we have a different vocabulary. It's a whole different world than it was 10 years ago. So how can we, you know, thrive in this new world?
100%. It's so important. And as we contemplate that, we're going to go to a break. I'm going to you know, simmer away at some lovely navy beans here, and we come back. We're going to continue cooking, because you've cooked on a podcast before, or you haven't?
I haven't cooked on a podcast
before. I love when it's the first time. All right, Rich, so you know you're cooking, right? That's the rule here.
I can keep up.
Yeah. I was saying to Rich in the break that the reason why I'm able to get some big dogs on here like Rich is because I say I cook. So that's the whole point we're doing here today. And so right now we've got these beautiful navy beans which have been soaking overnight. Now you can buy navy beans or any form of canned beans or lipids and they would come soaked. You just put them straight into a pot. But if you want to buy them at a more affordable rate, just get them as they are dry and then just soak them overnight and then boil them when you get them in the morning or the next day. So that's what we've got here in the pot. And I'm going to make a really nice curry. We had the chef iron that from Tame and also Balabus in yesterday. She's doing a little collab and she left me her preserved lemons. If you've never had preserved lemons, you probably actually have without knowing, but they're phenomenal. And Harrisa, a really nice spice paste. And she's just a wonderful individual. So we're going to make a nice little white navy bean curry as we talk about health specifically as it relates to men's health, Rich. So my man, like, let's start about with you. Are you someone who from a young age was into health? Or are you more journalism and then as a result of becoming the editor-in-chief of men's health have needed to learn more about men's health?
I would say that I was athletic when I was growing up, but I also grew up in like the 80s. So where I don't think, at least as far as like life in the suburbs, I don't think like health food had really penetrated.
Definitely
yet.
Not.
Like I didn't touch an avocado until I was in my
20s. Okay. Wow.
They're just like,
what was that moment like for you?
It was amazing. And I haven't looked back. So I don't think that I really became interested in personal health, particularly as it relates to nutrition, until I was about 25.
Right.
And that was because I started to notice, because I'm a genius, that how I ate impacted how I felt.
What?
I know. It's crazy.
Oh my Lord.
Call the journals. So so that's really when I started to educate myself on, you know, macronutrients and different types of nutrition information. So ever since then, it's just, because again, I'm not getting any younger. Ever since then, it's just something that I sort of built on year over year. And again, because of, you know, our understanding of nutrition and particularly health, it continues to change, continues to evolve as far as what's good for us, what can be better. That's something that I just, out of personal curiosity, and if not necessity, I keep up on.
Yeah, cool. And do you see that as actually quite vital or not so vital being the position you are? Like, do you have to be truly involved? Like, in all honesty, like, is it something that is a must? Or like, you know, I look at the brand of Men's Health. Rich is not Men's Health, but he guides it.
Yeah. Well, it's funny. I'll on my Instagram feed, I'll sometimes post stuff in the gym.
Yeah.
And all my friends will be like, don't you wish you were an editor of like Food and Wine?
Yeah. I've seen moments where you're with Liz.
Yeah. Sometimes it's tough. But I mean, I do get that question asked a lot. And I think I represent probably like 80% of our readers, which is that I'm not obsessed with going to the gym. And I am not, you know, super serious about what I eat. I do the best I can every day. Some days are better than others. But I think I'm driven to learn more. And I think, I sort of had the long term in mind, which is that like I'm doing the best that I can. But I've also got a really busy life. I've got a busy wife. I've got 3 little kids. I've got a, you know, a crummy commute. I've got all the things that most of my audience has. So I'm right there in the sort of daily trenches, just like everybody else.
I think that is the best way to summate this, because men's health isn't 6% body fat.
No, and that's why I love meeting our readers.
Right.
Because it's like literally they come in all shapes and sizes.
I love that.
And I love it too, because I think it really speaks to the fact that we're all motivated in different ways to become the better version of ourselves. Like, am I going to wake up and, you know, suddenly look like, you know, insert whomever, you know, here. It's, the answer is no. I'll probably wake up tomorrow and look kind of just like me. But who's that going to be? So what can I do? What choices can I make that will get me there? That will, you know, and at these days, it's really less about how I look and more about how I feel. That's sort of my North Star at this point, because that sort of dictates everything from how I sleep to how I interact with everyone in my family to how I interact with my staff. If I don't feel well, then everything else just sort of goes to pieces.
Yeah, ultimately that's what it's about, right?
Yeah.
Health and wellness isn't a solely an aesthetic thing.
It's no, and it's so also not about like blood test results. And again, all that is important. And I think, you know, for a lot of us, how we look is important. Like if I looked a lot differently than I do now, would I be like the ideal person to go out and represent men's health? Maybe not. But I should also say for people who are just listening to this, like I don't look like Chris Hemsworth. I think I'm a reasonably fit
Must be nice.
Guy. Yeah, exactly. I'm a reasonably fit guy, and I think that more than anything makes me have more in common with our readers.
Just quickly, did you say Chris Hemsworth because there's something just drew your attention to an Aussie?
Yes. So it was the accent.
Yeah.
Actually, he was just on our March issue.
Yeah. So have you heard of Santa?
That was the reason for us to do it.
Sure.
Was his new app.
So okay. I'm one of the chefs on that one.
Oh, you are?
Yeah. So doing all the content and fun times. So, you know, Chris can, I'll just handle the food. He can handle the good looks and whatnot.
Yeah.
But man, like I just love the way you've just concluded. You just said maybe you're not, you know, that person that people think about. But as you said, you actually embody what everybody, you know, every bloke is. Busy, family, commuting, all those kind of things. That's like, and still, you still are interested in mm-hmm. wanting to feel great,
mm-hmm.
which is what your content is all about.
Like,
your content isn't just lifting in a gym, not just food. You have style, you have leisure, travel places, things to do. Like, that's what you are. And so, my question, Anne, is if you look at when you first started to now, has the change been dictated by that vision, or have you personally seen the change it must have needed and then you adjusted accordingly?
I came in with the idea of how I could adapt the brand a little bit, and it was really important to me that I didn't come in as a sort of ego play and say like, I'm gonna make this all rich, right? Like I know better than anybody, because here there's this tremendously successful brand. As you said before, it's the biggest men's magazine brand in the world. Let's not get too, you know, high and mighty when it comes to what's going on here. A lot of it was working. The two things that I didn't think were necessarily working as well as they could have can sort of begin and end in the title of the brand. So you have men. So when people think about men's health, they tend to think about the cover guy, and it tends to be a middle-aged white guy who looks kind of angry and or constipated. And that was supposed to be tough, right? That was like strong and tough. And that to me didn't feel like a real reflection of what was happening with American men today. So it was really important to me to bring in men of different ethnicities and different ages and different orientations, different gender expressions, just sort of open up the tent a little bit. So it was really much more of a brand for everybody. Secondly, was this notion of health and what we mean by health. So traditionally people look at men's health and they think about, they go to, you know, lifting weights at the gym. And that's super important for a lot of guys as far as building strength, and strength is important in our daily lives. But there's so much more to our understanding of health now. So we have three sort of tentpole sections in the front of the book that sort of encompass what we're talking about. And it's body, mind, and life. And it's this idea that health today is a whole body, whole mind, whole life concept. So you can invest in yourself physically, and that's, yes, physical fitness, but it's also, you know, medical health and bodily health, physiology. There's mental health, and that can sort of orient itself in things that are more clinical.
Which is like, huge right now.
It's like, huge.
And should they?
Well, and it's very important. And, you know, you can talk about it in really sort of hard clinical ways, like anger, anxiety, and depression. Or you can talk about it in sort of softer ways, like compassion and empathy, grit and resilience. And then the third is just this notion that our lives are totally different than they used to be. And how we interact with the people around us and how we build the lives that we're living every day. So that comes down to how and where and why we work, how and where and why we partner with people, how we parent, how we get dressed in the morning. All these things are different than they were 10 or 15 years ago. So both the pages of the magazine, the content online, the videos we produce, all of that has to reflect those changes. So those were sort of my two mandates coming in, was really sort of redefine men and redefine health as you see them in the pages of the brand.
And how long have you been in the role for now?
About 14 months, 16 months.
And so have you seen, is that enough time to see some genuine, you know, not drastic, but, you know, I say rich?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I mean, at this point, like, I own it. Or in the sense
good
of like...
Good for you, man. Good for you.
Yeah. I mean, the Hearst family owns it.
Yeah, but you own the chain.
Yeah, no, and at this point, like, what you see in the brand, I am responsible for.
Awesome.
For better or worse. And I think, you know, if you look at something like we did just a few months ago, it was a big package that we did in our May issue, and we had the beautiful rollout online and on Apple News. And it was just a very simple question, which is, what is strength for? Think about that. We have never needed strength less in the history of humanity. We have something to do, something for everybody. We don't have to lift, you know, you can pay someone to do your errands for you. Most of us aren't working with our hands. We've got AI for everything. Like, so what do we actually need strength for? And so we talk about the experiences about 10 different men and how they are using strength in different parts of their life. So for one of them, it's how they overcame cancer, because there's a huge correlation between strength training and in certain types of cancer rehabilitation. There's a sumo wrestler who certainly doesn't look like the cover of Men's Health, but that's, you know, that's how he uses strength. There's a guy who wrestled a gun out of a gunman's hands during a live stick-up. There's a transgendered man who would go to his gym to work out so that he could become part of a community. There are all these different stories that people are using strength for different things. So just this idea that, like, you're going to pump some iron to look jacked, that's fine. But I think that's really only a small part of the larger story that we're trying to tell. And I think that's a good example of how we're looking at, again, men and health through a much broader lens.
Unbelievable. If that's one of your that's strength. What is strength for? Is
yeah,
Rich?
Yeah,
man, that is so cool.
It's on my staff, but yeah, it's all of us.
But like, yeah, of course, obviously. But that's a new age way of looking at what men's health is.
Well, it's new age, but I think it's also just realistic, and it's something that I think most of us can relate to.
Realistic? To use one of your phrases earlier.
Sure. No. Sure.
I love it, man. No, that's great. Like, I'm always talking about this holistic way. And you know, in the day, if I see a grandma who can squat, like, mm-hmm. just one body rep, that's great because it's functional for their body.
Yeah.
And that's what, you know, you want to have a happy life. Mm-hmm. Happiness, to me, is the key to your health, because mm-hmm. it embodies all the parameters that you spoke about earlier. Mm-hmm. And in that way, it means if those things are relatively all in check, you're going to be happy.
Yeah.
If there's one aspect of your day that makes you a little bit sad, whether it be a challenge at work, and something's not right at home, or you personally don't feel right inside, it's going to affect your happiness. So it's an indicator of that. But when we talk about health, health, as I said, is for so long been defined by an aesthetic aspect. And now, as you're really, you know, showing and guiding, it's actually so many things, but it's also within each category. Strength isn't about the ability to necessarily push a bench press.
No. And again, there's nothing to say that there's anything wrong with that.
No.
And to the visual aspect of it, I think a lot of us take comfort in how we look. And there's nothing wrong with that. If you're feeling really good in your skin, and as long as you're not sort of beating yourself up about, like, my fitness director, Eb, swears that one of his abs is broken. So like, he gets really hung up that he doesn't have a perfect six pack. let that sit in for sink in for a second. But
he doesn't. my abs broken.
Yeah, his abs broken. But again, if that brings you comfort and confidence,
sure,
feeling good in your skin, that says a lot, and that'll get you pretty far.
Unbelievable. Well, my next question to you, my man, as I drop in some coconut milk into our lovely white bean situation over here, I'm going to put that back on the heat, low, probably going to simmer that for about another 10 minutes. How much do you focus on food as it relates to both the magazine and within yourself? Like, you know, you said you got a family, beautiful family, three kids. How much is food a part of your life?
It is... well, vital part of my life, but it is because I have three kids, they eat very differently than I do. And I would love to say that I am part of a household where everybody likes to eat the same and everyone sort of has the same ambition with their food, and that is not the case.
Nope.
Particularly with an 8-year-old, a 5-year-old, and a 3-year-old. So I tend to eat a lot of meals. I do a lot of meal prep for myself, and
sure,
I tend to eat a lot of meals by myself, both because my schedule is sort of wonky, but also what I like in food tends to be a little bit more specific than what they're going for.
And do you see this kind of have an influence on the magazine, or do you kind of like just allow the food contributors and editors to kind of do their thing as well?
No, I mean, I think for the most part, I mean, our senior editor who oversees all our food coverage, Paul Keita, is tremendously talented and a great, great cook.
Nice.
And so I trust him with a lot. But I think my backstop tends to be two questions. One is like, would I actually cook this?
Yeah.
Like, how many moving parts are there? How many things do I actually have to buy? How, you know, intricate is the plating and the preparation process?
Sure.
And secondly, do I really want to eat this? Like, when I come home from a long day, is this really what's going to get me excited as I walk through the door? And so there, those are sort of the lenses that I use. He tends to apply a sort of more rigorous eye,
yep,
as far as, you know, nutritional value, overall health implications. So by the time things get to me, those things have already been determined and sort of greenlit. The rest just sort of comes from me as an advocate for the reader.
Nice. But that's a really good way. You're just essentially talking about food that is relatable.
Yeah.
Is it going to be something that our readers are going to look at and go, I'm actually going to do that?
Yeah.
It looks exciting, looks tasty, but I can accomplish that after coming home at, you know, 7 o'clock and right, still seeing the kids.
Well, and also, who's read a recipe and you're like, oh, that looks awesome, and there are 25 things you have to make and like all this stuff you have to buy and like obscure spices that you're never going to use again.
100%.
And you're like, I just can't. So we try to avoid that if possible, because we like to think that we're actually making something that isn't just like aspirational,
yeah,
right? Like this is something that our audience will actually do for themselves.
That's something I think, even from a personal experience with our content, is everything we want is, if you're the first time picking up a pan, you can do this.
Right.
We don't want you to feel like it's unattainable or you can't go and get it from the grocery store, as you said. And in this day and age, people actually do want to cook a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
They may struggle to do so, but they're definitely, as you said earlier, interested to find out more about it,
mm-hmm,
which is personally really exciting. Do you see that? I'm asking you, actually, it's a good person to ask. Do you see the change in food a lot in your readers?
Yeah, I mean, I think you see it. And again, not just in our audience, but you see a huge cultural shift over the last 10 to 15 years as far as the amount of time and effort that men are expending in the kitchen.
Yeah.
I think part of it is sort of the whole sort of just doing stuff with your hands thing. You know, dudes are really into building stuff and making stuff. and so they tend to really like fetishize some of the process, and whether that's like smoking or, you know, all the things that you hear a lot about. So yes, that's changing a great deal. But I also think you're starting to see more and more things like meal prepping,
yeah,
as something, as a sort of practical accommodation of our increasingly busy lives. So we have to, because we're coming home at 7 or 8 and because we've got a million other things going on, maybe we don't want to necessarily worry about what we're eating that night. So more and more people, we think, are using the weekends to sort of, you know, cook whatever they're going to be eating for the rest of the week, and then portion it out.
And do you see it's something that's very attainable? Like, I know it's a question that sounds obvious, but some people are actually struggling to find the time to even cook for themselves in this day and age.
I wouldn't say it's next to impossible, but I mean, we are all busier than we've ever been with more and more demands on our time. So there's that reality, but at the same time, I think there is a countervailing force, which is this idea that more and more of us understand the benefits of cooking for yourself, particularly when it comes to, you know, you're not getting a lot of the junk that comes in sort of overly processed, pre-prepared food. You get to really control and customize your food the way that you like it. So you have those two things competing for a person's time and energy, and we see more and more that the sort of impulse to cook for oneself is winning out.
Yeah, 100%. I had Adam Eskin, the CEO of Dig In, on the podcast a couple of weeks ago. He talked about, it's actually quite sad that when people taste their farmed food, people don't realize how good it is. It's because we actually don't know what real food tastes like anymore. But that's where, like, I guess it's like me, that's where I come in. My job is to make sure that people can attain that ability to cook more, at least know where their food comes from, have a relationship with food. I feel it's like actually something that's really crucial, and we've obviously had a lot of body image things in the past, but that's something that's quite apparent. Now, as we talk about this, I could just follow you around all day and cook for you, because as we are speaking, we've got in the pot, as I said, we had the white navy beans, we added the coconut milk, little beautiful low simmer, and to that we added some cayenne, some paprika, along with one of our preserved lemons we just sliced up was actually put out a quarter and just nice little cubes. Along with that, we have some of that harissa paste. Again, all these ingredients will be on the website and you can get them from all your regular supermarket. The preserved lemon may be a bit more tricky, so you can just use a regular lemon. And we just finished up with cilantro. So as we head to a break, my man, we're just gonna let this bubble just romantically send us off in tasty style. Rich, how's it smell, man?
It smells amazing.
Yeah,
it looks like an extremely, well, I won't say it. I was gonna say it looks, because again, I cook for toddlers. It looks like the best possible version of like a fancy mac and cheese.
Oh, nice, dude. I love that. I'm on it. That's great. Do you make mac and cheese?
I do.
Oh, do you?
I do. That is my second job. Making boxed mac and cheese.
I'm a professional mac and cheese maker. That's unreal. Dude, so we went to our fire round, but I do have one question for you. You spoke earlier about being a white male in the position you're in. Now, in this day and age, how conscious of you, of what you're, everything from your readers, for what you talk about day to day, just kind of talk about that, and how conscious are you of it with whatever you put out?
Yeah, I mean, I'm extremely conscious of it. And again, I think that's really one of the benefits of being alive today is that, 10 years ago or so, we weren't having these conversations about privilege. And I don't think that we necessarily understood what other folks may be going through, and whether that's people of color or whether that's women. I think over the last decade, I think a lot of our eyes have been opened to the everyday realities that we aren't, that white men in particular aren't facing. That's not to say necessarily that all our lives are easy. And that's not to say that we've been given everything that we have. But I think a lot of us are becoming more and more aware of the things that we don't have to deal with. And more of us are becoming more empathetic and more compassionate as far as understanding other people's experiences. That's certainly something that we focus on all the time throughout the brand, particularly as far as the types of people that we cover. I mentioned earlier, like sort of really opening up the tent to men of different ages and ethnicities and orientations. But also, one of the great things I think about being a man today is that there isn't necessarily a rule book as far as what it means to be a quote unquote normal man. You know, even when I was growing up in the 80s and 90s, there was a fairly rigid road that you could follow if you wanted to be quote unquote normal or typical. But I think over the last maybe 20 years, we've seen a lot of changes as far as what that means. And so I think it's becoming more and more easy to be whatever type of man you want to be and to live the type of life that you want to live without sacrificing or compromising. So whether that's who you love or the type of work that you do, where you live, all of those things are changing rapidly in a way that I think ultimately benefits everybody.
100%. Like making the realization of what the world actually is, as opposed to, unfortunately for some time, there were groups that were definitely not looked at in the right way. Mm-hmm. And so now it's up the responsibility for us to help, I think more so on us to really help set an example for everyone, mm-hmm. our kids, everyone following along.
Absolutely.
So on that note, set an example. How do you set an example in your mornings, mate? What is your morning routine?
My morning routine is I typically am up around 5:30. I wake up naturally at 5:30.
Just no alarm clock. Yeah. Good for you.
Yeah, no, not good for me. I wish I could sleep a little bit later, but unfortunately I can't. I'm married, so I sleep next to my wife, but she's a light sleeper. So I am as quiet as possible until 6 o'clock. I'll through my phone
because I don't want to wake.
Yeah, well, I just I don't want to. Well, no, I don't even get up because as soon as I get up, I wake her up.
Oh, nice.
So I reach over and I am sort of scrolling through it. I probably should be meditating or something when I first wake up, but I don't. I check my email and Instagram and yesterday's web traffic.
you do all that in bed. I love it.
I do. But then at 6 o'clock, which I think is like a reasonable hour for most people, I'll get up and I'll shower. And then I will go downstairs between 6:30 and 7 is really when I like get my head right. I will have breakfast. I will, meditate for a while. I'll sort of just put my phone away and just sort of like lay out my day mentally. And then my kids wake up typically around 7 and then all hell breaks loose.
Nice.
And then it's just kind of like a mad scramble for me to get them out the door and then to make a train and then to get to work. And then my day, I get sort of put on this crazy conveyor belt where, I typically have I'm in a lot of meetings. So, you know, I sort of ping pong between meetings throughout the day. And then, you know, between 6 and 7, I'm racing back to get on a train. I'll typically see one or two of my kids before bedtime. I typically don't see one or two of them. And that's if I'm coming home that night. Oftentimes, because of my job, I have to do things after work related to work. So sometimes I don't see them at all. But if I'm coming home, I'm typically home between, you know, 7 or 7:30. You know, give them a kiss goodnight, help with bedtime, and then, you know, collapse.
Yeah, nice. Is it, you actually highlighted something there with the meetings. So someone in your position asks the action. I talk about this all the time. It's like, if you're bouncing between meetings, you may be being receptive and listening to stuff, but you're not actioning anything. So how do you get the time to then action some of the things that went to your meetings? Did you have people in those meetings and you have a 5-minute break? All right, team, you're going to execute this. You're going to execute this. I'm off for my next meeting. Break.
Yeah. I mean, some of the meetings, I mean, I think that's one of the great gifts of being in a creative enterprise like journalism, is that a lot of those meetings are like, they're brainstorming meetings. So like we come in with, you know, a metaphorical white sheet of paper and we're like, we have to figure this out. What are we figuring out? So a lot of times we'll be driving the conversation in those meetings, trying to sort of form some consensus among different ideas for what we should do. Some of it is looking at Excel sheets. You know, those are other meetings, and those are obviously less fun, but there's a balance between the two, and my role in them shifts from time to time. What I like to try to do is, and this sounds sort of lame, but I do it anyway, is I schedule time with myself.
That's like, not
like,
lame at all.
I will block out.
Have you heard of Dan's thinking time? Maddie gives me Dan's thinking time.
There you go. I will, I'll typically try to schedule like an hour with myself. Not every day. I typically can't do it every day, but like three to four times a week, where I can like just sit there and just kind of do nothing, and I don't feel that the sort of need to answer emails. I'm not in any meetings, because I'm blocked off. People aren't necessarily coming to me, and again, I'm not like taking a nap. Like I'm catching up on stuff. I'm thinking through things. I'm trying to brainstorm my way through some things. Maybe I'll look at I'll scroll through the site, menshealth.com, and I'll just sort of like look at it with fresh eyes, which is always helpful because, again, when you look at it all the time through a much more critical lens, you miss things. I'll flip through a recent issue where like, I'll be like, oh, that was great, or I'll be like, what could we have done better here? Things like that you don't necessarily do when you're always racing and you're always on the clock. So that's like the one thing that I tend to do. I don't know what else I could do.
That's really well balanced, man, because, you know, you're often in the mental state of just constant go, 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 go. So you may look at something and try and analyze it, and your body can simply not contemplate anything.
Yeah.
So when you put that time aside to actually focus on, you know, it could be brain-free SWOT analysis, essentially. Mm-hmm. That's something we can all be better at in our daily lives. Like, how often do people actually set aside time to actually do a little analysis on what they did last week? Mm-hmm. We often just action. Whether it be, you know, how did I train that person, or how did I write, how well did I write that article? Did I do well in this recent exam? Like, mm-hmm. How often do we actually reflect on it? So someone like yourself, who's just like everyone, super busy and able to actually set aside time, is a really good example of that. That's awesome. I was going to say, it's actually ties into my second question, which is, I always talk about controlling the controllable. And obviously with time, it's, you know, our biggest commodity. But with you, you obviously have the ability to go, well, I control the controllable by making sure that I control when I'm going to have time to make sure that I can reflect.
Right.
Are there any other aspects of your day that you can control that you do, or aspects that you do by controlling the controllable?
Well, it's interesting. A sort of the other side of the coin of time is attention. And I think you can really control what you're paying attention to.
Nice.
And sometimes I'll catch myself worrying about something or dealing with something that I don't need to be doing at that moment. And I'm expending mental and sometimes physical energy on things that are not the best use of my attention. So people talk, and time is a tremendously precious commodity. I would argue that attention is a sort of second most important. So where you choose to focus, how you choose to focus, requires a lot of discipline. It requires a lot of energy. With those things, you can certainly control it and use it in a way that I think you'd really sort of see the benefit for.
That's amazing. I don't think I've ever had that kind of response before with that kind of question. That's epic. So just focusing is something we definitely, you know, we spread ourselves quite thin, quite easily. Mm-hmm. So be able to just go bang and focus on the task at hand. Mm-hmm. Incredible. So Rich, man, you've talked about the mac and cheese, but if you were a food, a meal, an ingredient, what would Rich be and why? What represent Rich? And this can be completely left center. It can be a berry from the native Amazon that just no one knows about.
I mean, I would say, I don't know if anyone's ever said this before, but I would say an egg.
No one has actually said that yet.
I find an egg to be, I mean, A, because I eat a lot of eggs.
Good for you.
I eat eggs every morning and I eat eggs throughout the day. And I just find it a tremendously versatile thing that one can eat. They're all different kinds of preparations. And that, you know, really good scrambled eggs or really good egg bake is a totally different experience than like a poached egg.
100%.
And I think you can also have it on its own or it can just be one part of something else. It is nutritional. It is sometimes misunderstood.
Love that.
Metaphor alert. Currently in the good graces, I think, of modern science. But yeah, I would say egg probably. And plus, you know, there's the whole giving of life and all of that.
Sure. So, no, sure. True. Yeah, right. That in itself is its own metaphor.
That other thing, yeah.
Yeah. So, mate, if you to look back on what you've done and to go through what you talk about with change, where do you see the next iteration of change that you will do with men's health? Like, have you foretold, have you seen what we need to adjust or, you know, be more versatile with or adaptive to?
That's a really great question, Dan. And I think something that we're focusing on is really putting more energy and attention on how men can adjust their lives and adapt their attitudes to thrive. And I don't want to say a post-Me Too world because that would seem like Me Too is over, which it's not, of course. Sure. Like we're still fully reckoning with millennia of bad behavior.
Yeah.
But I think we're all continuing to learn and to adjust how we interact with women on a sort of individual personal level, but also in a larger cultural and systematic way. And I think men in particular really need help with that because I come at it, it's either naive or generous, however you want to look at it, but I think most men are good guys. Who've maybe done some stupid things or who don't know that they're doing stupid things. So how do you take the position that to start the conversation in a way that doesn't automatically put someone on the defensive, right? Because I think like that's when you get into like hashtag not all men and all of that. And I don't think that's a tremendously productive way of addressing the topic. So how do you initiate the conversation from a place of empathy and generosity, which is that like, look, we know that you're trying to do better. We know that you're trying to be a better partner, a better coworker, a better parent. But here's the experience, according to other people. Here's how women have been telling us this, not just for the last 18 months, but for the last, you know, depending on how much you've been listening, for the past, you know, couple decades. Here's how you can change your life in a way that not only benefits the women in your life, because don't they deserve it, but also you, because I don't think there is necessarily a downside for anybody in a place where we all feel safer and more respected and that we're all treated equally and with dignity. So that's an ongoing project, right? And I think that's a great project of our generation of men, which is, and again, this is a generation-long process because I think it starts when we're really young. I think it starts with socialization that we see in young boys. I think it continues on as you look at more sort of middle-aged guys, which I'm not quite middle-aged yet, but I see it in guys who are a little bit older than me, that they grew up a certain way, right? Like they saw their parents behaving a certain way and they've sort of modeled themselves after that. So there's some correction that has to go on there. And then you've got the older folks who, again, just because they grew up in literally a different world than the rest of us, they're not bad people. They just don't know any better. So I think a brand like Men's Health is in a unique position. It's one of the reasons I was really excited to come to the brand was to speak to all these different categories and all these different types of boys and men in a way that ultimately gives them the information and inspiration they need to be a positive part of this change. Because the change is happening. Like, read blogs, go online, go on your social feed. Like, the world is changing incredibly rapidly. And it is incredibly important that we are a positive, affirmative part of the change. Because I think that way, there's no downside for anybody.
Oh, man, that's powerful. That's that, like, take note, people. That is massively powerful. Just responding to what is needed, but what is to do good. And I love the way he phrased it in the sense that it's not like they just didn't know any better. And then there's people who now have the ability to be educated as a sponge because it's early days. So you're really looking at it as a way of going, look, we can all come together on this. It's just a way of communicating in the right fashion. Rich, mate, it's been an absolute pleasure having you here in the studio kitchen today and to cook up your lovely white bean harissa curry. Mate, where can we find out more? Obviously, pick up a magazine, Men's Health. I'm a massive fan, been so for probably, I think, over 17 years now, I think about it. So I'm a fan. You can obviously hit up Men's Health on Instagram. Anything else, mate, you would like to highlight?
I mean, we are wherever fine content is consumed. So you can look, you can find us on newsstands, you can subscribe to us, you can go to menshealth.com, you can look up for Men's Health on YouTube, on Instagram, on Facebook, we're on TikTok.
TikTok?
We're on TikTok.
Wow.
For the kids in the audience.
How
so
good.
We are a true cross-platform brand, and we, you know, we try to do our audience right wherever they find us.
Well, man, like I can personally say, at least you've got one person you've looked after for at least, you know, 15 years. So I just want to say thank you very much for what you and the team are doing. I know you've had the role for 14 months and I look forward to seeing what the next 14 months looks like as I pour over your lovely harissa curry.
Amazing.
Some nice grain quinoa.
Look at that.
My friends, make sure you, you know, if you like this episode, leave a review. Give us a little shout out, obviously, to Rich and the team as well at Men's Health. And of course, hit subscribe so you make sure you get people like Rich every single week. Rich, I reckon we just jump into this.